Good morning, this is April the 17th, 1997, and we're at the home of Captain Andy Rasmussen. Andy, tell us when you first came to the island.
When I first came?
What year was that?
Let's see, wait till I get it straightened out now. During the war, I came here right after the war. During the war, I was in worked in an airplane factory out in Chula Vista, California. That's south of San Diego, right on the Mexican border. And my wife and I lived there for about 3 years during the war while I worked in the airplane factory. But then when the war was over, then we moved back up into Missouri, Caruthersville. I was in the carnival business, and we had stored our truck and our carnival business. We had stored that all in Caruthersville, Missouri, on the fairgrounds. There was a building there. Well, during the war, everything kind of stored away, you know. So then, let's see, that was, which was that be?
That must have been interesting, too, being in the carnival business.
Oh, yeah, I was in that for years after I moved here.
Oh, really?
What did you do in the carnival business?
I had concessions, games.
Oh, I see.
Shooting galleries, mostly. I had two kinds of shooting gallery. I had a regular one with 22s, and then I had two of them with cork guns. Cigarette shooting gallery, we called it. Shot at the cigarettes, knock them off the shelf, think you could have them. But I'd have the cigarettes, you know, in their packages and have them sitting there. And we used cork guns.
Yeah.
And of course, you couldn't shoot them straight, you know. And I had two of them, one on each side of the midway on the big shows. Besides my regular gallery I had, I didn't have it so long in the regular rifle range, you know. But I went into the show business. The guy that had a shooting gallery, they'd come to my hometown when I was just a young fellow, just got out of school, and they were showed up in a field there near where we lived, and I got acquainted with the guy that had man and his wife. They were elderly people, and I got acquainted with them. I'd go out there and visit with them, and they finally talked me into going with them. So I worked for them for about a year, I guess, you know, in the summertime. And then I finally got my own, made one of my own and went on it. That was back in, that was before the war, yeah. And after the war.
Were you in the service?
No. I went out to California there, my wife and I, and I don't remember what did we do, go out there for, but anyway, we got a place to park our trailer in a little trailer park there in Chula Vista. That's just south of San Diego, Chula Vista. Nice, just a little town. And I got a chance to go to work in the airplane plant, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, so he was deferred then.
Yeah. So I worked there all during the war. And when the war was over, that job went done, my wife went back and we found down in Caruthersville, Missouri, in the fairgrounds, the building that had our carnival stuff in had caught on fire while we were gone. But most of my concessions were still pretty good. They were there. They got them out, you know, they were in a truck. Well, that was right after the wars. And I, from there on, but how we got down here, my wife's folks were poor Arkansas people, and somehow or other, during the war, they got to come down here and on Lake Okeechobee and work down there in the bean fields and that. They were just poor people, you know, and we decided to go down and see them. So we went down to see them, And on the way back, I told my wife, I says, we're going to see some people here, the show people had taken over building the park. So the park wasn't much here then, just big buildings up front, you know, and that. And they had taken over to a parking, and they made a trailer park out of it. And when I come in here from that from my since my wife's folks, when we drove in here, they had told us about where it was, you know, and we parked just where we wanted. We just pulled in, there was only one entrance up there. We pulled in and just parked. Of course, this was all a swamp here then, you know, this was left one. And we parked anywhere as we wanted to. There wasn't no regulars. It was just like in a pasture. And then, so the next year, we stayed, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks.
Did you say there were circus people living here?
Yeah, carnival
and
people.
And the ringling?
They were some of the ones that really started the park.
That's it.
And that's how come we come over here.
Do you know what year that was that the park started?
Not for sure.
It was 30s? After the war then, though. So.
It was right after the war, though.
Yeah.
Of course, there was the hotel and everything 40s. Was up in front and all that, you know.
That across park, across the golf park.
Yeah. Yeah. So, then when we left here, my wife, she says, we're going up to pull on our trailer, a small trailer, and we're going up the highway and towards Tampa, and she said, I don't care if I never come down here no more.
Oh.
I liked it down here, you know, because I fished a little bit with somebody. And so the next year, we were up in Wisconsin, and right on the border of Illinois, there in Wisconsin, they have a Labor Day, big Labor Day fair there. And we were there, and in the carnival business, when you work at a fair, you work, because you work day and night, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And we worked, and when the midnight quiet, we started to tear down. And my wife, she says, what are we going to do now? And I says, I don't know. I says, what do you think we ought to do? She says, why don't we go down and see up my folks down in Florida? That's where I wanted to go. I says, we'll do that. So we worked, and then as soon as we got the stuff all stored in the truck, well, then we stopped down in Missouri and put it in winter quarters there, you know. That's how we got down here. And I was tickled to death on the first trip on the way back up there. My wife all week is going up the road, and she says, I don't care whether I ever come back here anymore, you know. That's what I kind of
changed
thinking.
Your mind.
Yeah, I got to figure how I get. But after that Labor Day, we worked day and night there for about 24 hours, you know, setting up, tearing down on the end of it. Oh, she says, I'm sure glad we get this done and get back to Florida, she said. That's what I've been waiting for all year.
Well, that was good.
How'd you ever get around to becoming a captain, though, and getting a boat and all that stuff?
When I was a kid, and I was born and raised in Nebraska on the Platte River, you know where that is, I guess. That's the main, goes all the way from Omaha, Nebraska, all the way out to Denver, Colorado, practically, the Platte River does.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to fish in that with my brothers. My older brothers, they'd go fishing from sandbar to sandbar. The Platte River's a wide river, but it's shallow. Got deep parts in it, but most time we waded from one sandbar to the other. And we had my brothers had a long line with about 12, 15 hooks on, you know. And I carried the bait, and they'd plug them in from sandbar to sandbar, you know, with sticks. And I'd carry the bucket with crawdads for them, and they'd put. Pick the fish off the hooks and put bait on, just from sandbar to sandbar, waiting for my brothers were older.
Catfish, you know. Or
what? Catfish, mm-hmm. Mostly. Once in a while, we'd get a carp or something. We didn't ever eat the carps. If we got carps, we had some neighbors that were Jewish people, and if we got carps, we give them to them. They didn't eat catfish. They had to have fish that had scales on, something in their religion. I don't remember now what it was all about. If we got any carps and that, we brought them home, and that neighbors, the Jewish people, they were tickled to death with them, you know. That's a long, some of that stuff kind of is running together, you know, so long ago. Yeah.
So when you finally decided you want to stay here in Brandon Beach, what did you get, a trailer, or what did you get?
Yeah, well, I had a trailer then. We lived in a trailer, and I got a picture of that trailer. It's just a little box almost, you know. This trailer, I parked here. I still didn't park it solid. I parked here quite a long time after I was in the show business, because I had different boats, you know. I had a 30-foot boat that I left here parked. I took it down to Sarasota and left it. I don't remember now. There was a place there where I stored it in a place at a dock there. But the days and the times gets mixed up. But I fished all the time. I like to fish, you know, on account of with my brothers. I always fished with them. When I was just 10, 11 years old, I fished with them, you know. I carried the bait and that. But
so then after you settled here, you opened you started a boat business, or what was that, a charter or fishing? Or?
No, well, for the first couple of years, I just fished. But after I got this trailer here, then I parked it here when they made this here place here. The guy that owned it, he asked me, told me, he said what they were going to do, and he had a design of all this down here when they were going to fill it in and everything. It was just a swamp, you know. And he made a diagram, and he told me, he said, there's six trailers in what he was showing me. There's three here and three behind here. And it was just, he showed me the diagram, and I says, he said, you can have any one you want. Of course, I helped him with everything in the park, you know, when I come down here. So I said, that looks like a good corner there. That's yours, he said. When you come down next year, that'll be all filled in, and there'll be a place to park. So when I come down the next year, I had bought this trailer here then, and when I come down, I parked at this trailer right here. I had it back and forth. I fished, and I had a boat, and a tomahawk it was called, and I fished from here to Marathon. I could go down just by myself. It took me 3 days, so I fished most of the time, and I'd sell the fish in the different places, you know, and like in going down the Marathon. When I got into Marathon, I fished from the lowest part of the over across there, you know, I fished across. And at that time, that took me 3 days, and then I got on a bus and come back and to pick up my wife and the trailers, and then we lived in Marathon for a couple of months fishing. Mm-hmm. I was fishing. And, I fished all the time.
Were you a captain then? Had you got your captain license then? Were you a captain then?
Well, I didn't. I just fished my own boat.
Uh-huh.
No, I didn't have no captain license yet then. I got the captain's license later when I went to work. A fella had that big boat over here.
Cortez?
Yeah. And I went to work for him, and then I got my license then.
Mm-hmm.
But I finally, I went to work on the big boats. I had my little boat too quite a while, but I fished with it sometimes, but I worked with him too. But
fishing's not like what it used to be, is it?
No, no, no.
I just found a picture here, some big fish.
Yeah.
This is you over here?
Yeah. I don't even know who gave me that picture, but somebody did.
The
one next there, that's Captain Johnny Johnson there. He was, I think he just went deckhand then, and then he got a captain's license after that too, yeah.
It's an awful big fish.
Oh yeah, yeah. Oh, we caught a lot of big ones, yeah. Yeah.
Well, what's happened to the fishing?
That's a Jewfish, isn't it?
What's happened to fishing around here?
I fished, a good friend of mine that was in the show business with me, he started fishing with me a lot, and he lived up in Indiana, and he said, Andy, he said, I'd like to have a boat like this. That's after I was on the the big boat, you know, the Admiral. And he says, if I buy this boat, he said, will you stay down here and operate it in the wintertime, you know? I said, yeah. So he bought the boat and turned it over to me. Everybody thought I owned it, but I didn't own it. And I'd make the money and send him money, you know, and everything. Mm. And I did that for a couple of years. That it was kind of interesting, you know, for me to do that. Didn't have nothing invested, and still I was the main captain.
Mm-hmm.
But he sold it. He sold the boat there, and I don't remember. That was quite a few years later. I worked for him for quite a few years. He sold the boat, and the guy that bought him bought another one. We had two admirals, the Admiral and the Admiral II.
Yeah.
This other fellow bought him, he had bought this Admiral II up in on the East Coast, up in can't remember the name of the town, but his wife drove us up there, and we took over the boat, and we took it down from, remember the name of the town where it was from, on the East Coast up there.
Yeah.
And him and I, we come down with it. It was a real nice boat. That was, we named it the Admiral II. That was the second one of the Admiral II.
Yeah.
Hmm. That was a nice big boat, too.
So well, what was the island like back in the 40s?
Well,
what was the entire island like back in the
40s? Well, it was, there was no bridge over here. The bridge was the old bridge down there. It's still... Well, it ain't there, the old bridge ain't, but they made
that wooden bridge.
Yeah, it was. They made that bridge down there, the new bridge. But the old bridge was the old wooden one. That's what I got pictures of the here, those big fish that we caught. And we couldn't put him in the boat. There was four of us. It was in my smaller boat. And there wasn't room in the boat for him. There were four of us. We towed him in.
Big, what kind of fish?
Jewfish. A big jewfish we caught on that little boat of mine.
You catch him here in the bay?
Huh?
Did you catch him in the bay?
No, we caught
out
him
in the
out
Gulf.
In the Gulf. Just,
uh-huh.
Just a little ways offshore, about half a mile, we caught that big jewfish out there. And he was so big that we couldn't put him in the boat with us.
Mm.
He was too big, which is a boat, was a small boat. And some of the pictures I'll show you when we get to them. And we towed him, and the old bridge, the old wooden bridge was still there, you know. And there's a fella had a little truck with a thing sticking back, the hoist, you know. And we'll come to it and all them pictures. And I walked, we tied the boat off to the bridge. And I went up to on Bridge Teak where this fella had this little shop, you know, and that. And he come down on that old wooden bridge, and he dropped the hook, put this thing out, dropped the hook down, and we put the big old jewfish. He was about 400 pounds, and we put him on the hook, and he lifted him up. And that's pictures. I got pictures of him there. It was people standing getting their picture taken by him. The fish was bigger than the people standing by him.
Yeah, I guess so.
That was after they brought him up here to the park.
Yeah, it was a
big
one. We
had quite a celebration up here on the park with that. That's all them pictures. Well, there's some of them right there. Yeah, that's the same thing.
A lot of fish.
Got a lot of fillets out of that, huh?
Yeah.
Do you eat jewfish?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're all right, jewfish. They're big, but...
But they don't seem to be catching many fish.
They're not allowed to catch them now, you know?
I don't think so.
No.
I was going to see if you... I'm going to show you that with a little... Well, you can't tell it, but see, there's an arm right out here.
Yeah.
Well, that's what that, where the little thing, that truck that the fellow brought up. I got some other pictures. This is a fellow that caught a Jack Roll here in his wife. Yeah, wasn't that a big one though?
Yeah.
Well, we couldn't get in the boat with it. We towed him in.
Hmm.
Caught him right offshore here, and this less than a mile offshore.
Huh. So were more people coming to the park then?
Yeah, it was growing then. Yeah. Yeah, it was growing. That was before this was, let's see, was that before I moved?
Was it
here.
Called Golf Park or?
Golf Park, yeah.
Golf Park. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was Golf Park.
And
there was a
fish.
Tarpon. Old hotel building up there first.
Then they burnt down, didn't it? Hmm? The Golf Park Hotel.
Yeah.
Burnt down.
It finally burned down.
Did you know any of the Davises? Melvin Davis or Captain Bill Davis?
Yeah, I think I did.
Yeah, you must have known some of them. And one of them was the bridge tender, I think, after they got the new bridge open.
Yeah, that old wooden bridge. I always think about that fish. It was so big we couldn't put him in the boat with us. We didn't have a very big boat.
So tell me, what is this Beachcombers?
Well, I originated that 50 years ago.
What was that?
At first, we done had things we did, you know, contests. And then after that the contests were over, then we'd initiate the newcomers. And we did that all in years.
Just with people that lived here in the park?
Yeah. The newcomers got initiated every year. And they still did. When that picture was taken this year, we initiated a whole bunch mm-hmm. of them up there. And they have a lot of fun at it. They made a big celebration.
This article says that you first came to the park in 1929 to visit in-laws.
Yeah, well, that's about right, yeah.
It also says you're 92.
Hmm?
Are you 92?
No, they got that wrong one there.
How old are you?
88. Yeah, no, they got that lie. And when you come in the door here, they'd ask you, you know, if you had been initiated.
Oh.
And if you hadn't been initiated, then they put you over in a site. And like this year, there must have been 20 people that were initiated.
Oh. And was that a secret ceremony?
Yeah.
That you can't tell me about?
This big curtain made it like two rooms there. And when you come in the front, somebody told you if you hadn't been initiated, no, then they held them. And then later on, they'd start initiating them.
Hmm.
They'd bring them one at a time around there, and the people that were living in the park and were initiated, they were all back there watching them initiate the others. They had quite a time. And there were some of these, the Canadians over here, they'd done a lot of work on it. And a couple of them was back behind, and when they bring one of them persons in there to get initiated, like, they'd holler, no, make like somebody was killing them or something back there. And the people that was waiting to get initiated, they could hear it, but they didn't know what it was all about. And they howled and carried on, and it was fun.
Yeah.
I laughed at that.
Did you know, I'm sure you did, when Billy Martini lived here in the park?
Oh, yeah. She was, she finally got to be on the city council up in...
That's right.
I'll show you pictures of Billy and her dad and her mother.
Green, what was her name, Green?
Greenfield? Greenwell.
Greenwell.
Pete Greenwell.
Daisy.
And Daisy, yeah. They're both gone. I haven't seen Billy. I wouldn't know her if she come here.
Is that right?
I haven't seen her for years.
Hmm. Well, now you were on the Brandon Beach Council.
Yeah.
What year was that? Do you remember?
I don't remember exactly.
Or was that when Dick Connick was
mayor?
Yeah,
Dick Connick and I, we were the rulers there for a while.
Oh.
That's how come we got this nice shuffleboard court here.
Oh.
The shuffleboard court was up front. In fact, on that picture there, the shuffleboard court was just off a little. I don't think you can see it on there, but it was off right over where that one place where that tree, where the, and it was back there. But in the later years, then, after the big old ore house burned down, then they were starting to build the one that's up there now, the big one over there.
Did they ever figure out why that burned?
Not for sure, no. I think somebody set it on fire. I think some marijuana smokers or something was up there. They used to have quite a time up there. But that shuffleboard court was up there. And it, when they were starting to build that big building up there now, one day somebody said, "Hey, Andy," I was on the city council then, you know. "Andy," he said, they've got some bulldozers up there. They're wrecking, they're going to wreck our shuffleboard court."
Uh-huh.
And I went up there and seen it, sure enough. And I called Dick Connick, and he come down. I told him what they're doing, and he hurried down. And he told him, "Whoa, hold on, don't ruin that shuffleboard court." And we made a deal with the people that was building the big condo up there that they could have that shuffleboard land, provided they built a brand new one for the people in the park. So Dick and I, we got together, and that's supposed to be a street through there, see where it is now? That street that's up there was supposed to go all the way through, but there wasn't no people on it, there wasn't nothing down here yet. So we got the city council, and we stopped them guys from building. And then they made a deal with us that if we let them go ahead and do that, they would pay for a new shuffleboard court. And we could found that spot, and we cut the road off, blocked it so they could put it. And they had a company from somewhere inland Florida come and built a beautiful shuffleboard court. And when they'd still come and take care of it. That was all in the agreement for the condo up there. They had to pay for that shuffleboard court and everything.
When we were talking about the beachcombers, you didn't show your plaque that you got for 50 years of beachcombers over there on the shelf.
This one here?
Yeah, can you show that to George?
He saw it, didn't you?
Yeah, but he's going to get it on the camera.
Oh, I know what you mean. You want a picture of it.
50 years of beachcomber days.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Your other people were Jack Rowe and Dick Dodge.
Yeah.
The three of them.
Dick Dodge was the owner of the park.
And Larry, somebody.
That one name I can't place what it is.
Mm-hmm. That's a nice plaque, yeah. That's a good one. Thank you.
And then they have a larger one up at the hall.
Have they got a larger
that's
one?
That's what
there?
Jimmy said.
Yeah. Oh, that's what I was going to say. If they didn't have one up there, why'd let them have this one?
Well, from those early...
That wasn't nothing then. There was a beach there, but it wasn't nothing run by anything. It was just a beach there, you know, in the pass and all that. Of course, now it's all different, you know, since they built the bridge across and everything. But, of course, the bridge has been there a long, long time. But there was a time when I first fished with the big boats, they didn't have it. They built it after I was started fishing the big boats, the Admirals.
You mean the one over to Longboat?
No.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you meant the Cortez Road Bridge.
No, the one over to across the Longboat there, yeah.
That bridge was destroyed in the storm, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, they had to rebuild it once, yeah. Yeah.
How about storms? Do you remember any really bad storms?
Well, yes. I was trying to think. We had one storm. We took the big boat and took them up the river up there a ways. I can't remember just what year it was. But we've had some bad storms. One of the worst ones we had was last year, that little hurricane that come through here. Yeah. The water just come up to the top, but didn't come in here.
Wow.
And it stayed here for 24 hours, you know. Well, you were probably here then, wasn't you?
That was pretty close, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Almost come in, huh?
One or two trailers got water in them, you know. Mine, I didn't. It didn't quite make, but the tide was so high, it was the salt water that made it. Well, yeah. It wasn't rain, it was the salt water from the tide. Yeah. And like it was in the yard here for 24 hours before it receded. Yeah. And it ruined flowers and, well, our grass is better. It's good now, but it's been kind of brown. There's so much salt water in the ground around here. Mm-hmm. But it's all taken care of now. It's all got out good again. The grass is nice and green now. It has been for a month or so.
But that looks better than ours.
Did the people on the island, when the storms came, did they usually stay here?
Most of them did, yeah. It was a worse storm than what we figured it was. Of course, the winter people weren't here yet. I laughed because there's one that lived up the way here. I played cards with him and that. Him and his wife come down the street and the water was about that deep in the car. And I was out there waiting around. I says, what in the world are you doing down in the water? He says, we just come in. Uh-huh. And here they cast the day, they come into that bad storm. Uh-huh. And so he went on up, and then later on I waited up. The water stayed there for 24 hours, you know. And I waited up there, and his was one of the few houses that got water in the house. Uh-huh. It was about that deep on his uh-huh. In there.
He lives on
Fifth Street there, up right on the cross channel. There's two. There's a where we play cards. It was a toilet when they first come here. It's just a square. There's two of them. One over there on between second and third, and that one. And they had a partition between them and a door on each side. And one side was women, the other was men. See, but now they don't have that anymore. You know. Another thing, when we first parked our trailer somewhere up in the park, there wasn't no sewers or nothing. There was just them two toilets. And outside of them, they had a bowl. In the our toilets in the trailers, we just had sop jars, like, you know. Uh-huh. And that one had a bowl outside that you could go dump your slop jar in when I first come here. Of course, that's what all we used all the time. In them days, we didn't hook our trailer up to nothing, you know, when we was in the show business. Hmm. Yeah.
Well, are you glad you settled here?
Oh, yeah. I like it here, yeah. My wife liked it here. And we could go once in a while down and see her folks down on Lake Okeechobee, you know, and that. Her sister was here. Not too long ago, she called on the phone, or her daughter called on the phone, said they were coming by, and that they were on their way down to see some of the other family down on Lake Okeechobee. So they called to be sure I'd be here, you know. And when they come, and my sister-in-law, she's still able to get around, but she's pretty old. She's younger than I am, but. She was the youngest.
She's pretty old, but she's younger than he is.
Yeah.
You get around pretty good, too.
Yeah. She got one of them canes with the four prongs on the bottom, what I mean? I don't know what they call them, but she's got one of them. And then she'd tell me, you ought to have one of these. I says, well, I might someday, but I'm still sneaking around. I was tired today. I took a nap afterwards. My butane tank got all rusted out on the bottom, and had all kinds of big flowers, or they don't bloom. Well, they do, one of them or so, but they were just solid on that side of my trailer, and this butane tank was right in the middle of them. And a fella next door, he's always poking around anyway, and he's was over there, and he tore some of the stuff out, the flowers or the plants out, and it was all rusty down on the bottom. So I called the people, the Dipweilers, and they come down, the guy come down. They put a new tank in. That was just a couple days ago. I haven't got the bill yet for it. I don't know what it's going to cost. But I went out there and helped him. It was so much of that big growth. Well, if you see that, I got it all piled out there. I got a big pile of it waiting for the garbage
trash
man.
People, huh? Mm-hmm. Yeah. But,
well, what's nice there is you have a lot of trees around your trail.
Yeah, and he's not right up against somebody else, yeah, being on the corner,
yeah,
here.
Yeah, the best spot.
Good location.
Yeah. Yeah. No, this is a good location.
Yeah. Yeah. So you practically lived in a trailer all your life, haven't you?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
In the carnival business.
When I was a, let's see, I graduated from high school up in Nebraska there in, what was it, 27? I guess it was. And I went in the show business pretty right away. There was no jobs for kids or anything in them days much, you know what I mean, when they young. My father was a brewmaster at the brewery in town there. And when the country went dry, when Prohibition come, the brewery closed up. And he stayed down there quite a bit and made beer down there in the big crocks, you know, for the Germans that owned the brewery there. And I get a kick out of it. I'd help him after Prohibition. He's down there and kind of looked after the brewery and all the stuff in there, you know, and everything for a while. And finally he quit it. And I'd go with him, and we'd go to these Germans, rich fellows. We'd go to their place and put a big crock of beer on the basement. I'd help my dad there do it, and we'd bottle it. He had a capper, you know. He had a tube that he filled with bottles, a big quart bottle. Then he'd push them over to me, and I had this little cap of, and we'd done that at about four different guys that used to be owners in the brewery there, and we made a living doing that, making home brewing there right after that. I was just a kid. I was still going to school. And then some days I think about that.
Well, you want to show us some of your pictures?
Yeah. What do you like to see?
Who? Clyde Ford? Oh, yeah.
He's the outdoor editor.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. This is my nephew here. I didn't notice it until the other day. I have to be looking at him. I thought he lives here in the park now.
Oh, good.
The trailer he lived in, his mother died, and then after he lived in the trailer by himself about a year, and it's.
Deletions or corrections, I'd like to hear them, and we'll make the appropriate changes. If not, I'll entertain a motion that they stand approved as printed.
I so move.
And a second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Countersign? Motion carries. We'll now have the treasurer's report, please.
He's amending it.
It's not ready yet. All right. Are we in the black?
Always in the black. Well, the deal members, that's the only reason why we stay in the black. As of, let's see, get my brain in here. These are our disbursements. George Norwood, $23.59. That was for supplies for the, excuse me, I'm going to jump ahead. That was wrong. Frame Factory, we spent $21.02 for island framing the island photo. And then Norton's Camera, we made 25 copies of the couples on the beach. Classic Business Machine, we repaired our copy machine that worked pretty diligently out of the center. FP&L, the electric, 7884. Culligan's, that's our water that we drink down there, 2849. George Norwood, 9293. That was for pictures, mats, frames, and glass. Florida Department of Revenue, this is a big one because we're now paying quarterly on our sales tax. $204.24, GTE, $50.13, George Norwood, $33.58, that's copy toner for our copy machine. And we had, excuse me, four deposits, one for $614.39. Our interest for 2 months was $10.12. And our deposit, $626.96. And I don't have our perpetual fund because I didn't receive our update on that. We're working to try to change something on that. As we sit tonight, in our checking account is $8,822.06.
Do I have a motion for approval of the treasurer's report?
I so move.
In a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, otherwise?
I gave the wrong figure.
Uh-oh.
Checking account balance is $8,238.67. I was reading total paid.
Thank you. Committee reports. Does the Bread Committee have a report for us?
Oh, we are. For the five Wednesdays since our last meeting, our settlers, Brent Bakers, baked 79 loaves. If you want to buy a loaf or two of early settlers bread, you better come the next two Wednesdays to the museum, because as I understand it, our summer season begins the 1st of May, and we won't be baking early settlers bread during the summer. Last summer, we slaved over hot ovens, and probably will never recover from that. I'm going to do that again.
Could we have a report from museum sales, please?
Oh, jeez.
Well, sales are going on. I understand we've sold two of the big, the large aerial views of the island at Jack Elkins, and they're very popular.
What do they cost?
Well, framed, what did you sell them for?
$100 plus tax.
They're beautiful. That's a good bonus.
Yes, it is. Considering that we're framed and glass here. And we've sold quite a few shirts lately, but still have many more shirts to sell. And we have some of the cardigans, the one-size-fits-all cardigan that made out of sweat material that's very popular. Anybody that's going north, well, it's a good thing to have.
Any report from the docent committee?
Yes, the volunteers have done an incredible job. I guess they're going to be a little relieved that we're cutting back to one shift a day, and we'll be contacting each of the volunteers to make a fair distribution of the hours over the summer. About a week ago, we had our coffee for the docents, and we handed out a handbook that Al Butterfield and Alan Gilchrist were so kind to prepare to give us the text that from which we prepared this handbook. And we may make some available for members at the museum if you're interested. It's basically the tour of the museum, but on the back it lists all the key dates of the big happenings on the island, and that's always kind of nice to know as well. I guess that's all. Hopefully next month we can express our appreciation to everybody after a really, really busy year.
Thank you, Marilyn. I first saw this handbook this afternoon. It's impressive. It's worthwhile looking at, and maybe we should consider selling it in the museum. We'll think about it. Any report from the membership committee?
Well, we've had three new members since last time. I would like to remind the membership that if you're in doubt as to whether or not you paid your dues for 1997, I have a list here and I can tell you.
Thank you, Alice. Are there any other committee reports that I've overlooked?
No.
If not, I'd like to make you a director's report for this afternoon's meeting. A few items you should be aware of. There was a motion made and approved that we have as a money-making project for next season, assembling a historical calendar for sale in the calendar year 1998. That went over big, and I think the last time we did it was 1994. and we think it would be a good idea to repeat it. It was also moved and seconded that Martha Stewart be chairperson of the calendar committee. A motion was made to approve to present certificates of appreciation to those members who have performed outstanding service. And to that end, the board of directors would appreciate receiving any names of members whom you consider should receive this honor. Give us these names, or Marilyn George would be a good person to give them to also. Perhaps the most important motion that was made and approved was that we have a paid administrator, preferably from within the Anna Maria Island Historical Society, to oversee all and any events of the society. We've gotten to the point where there's a lot to do, and we need somebody who will accept this responsibility and be willing to be paid for it. We figure it's going to be a part-time job that takes full time. But it probably won't be paid even at part-time rates. We'd like to know if you have any thoughts on this, because I figure if we're going to pay an administrator, we're talking, I don't know, a couple hundred dollars a month. More than a couple hundred dollars a month.
There you go, Mike.
Can I nominate somebody?
There you go.
Well, give names to the directors so they can consider. What I would like to have tonight is the agreement of the membership at large to back up the motion that was approved by the directors, simply because of the amount of money involved on a yearly basis. I'd entertain a motion for that end.
I'd like to make that motion very, very strongly.
All right, we have a motion in the second.
You want a recommended salary, you want the board director.
I think the board should work on that. The board knows the parameters they have to work within anyway. But this is a motion to have a paid administrator, preferably from within the Anna Maria Island Historical Society, to oversee all and any events of the society. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carries. Thank you very much. I know we are going to have a report from the nominating committee regarding the slate of nominations for next year.
The nominating committee consisted of Jack Dietrich, Sylvia Snyder, Ruth Burkhead, and I. And we're happy to name the following people for your consideration. President Marilyn Maroney, Vice President John Deem, Treasurer George McKay, Corresponding Secretary Sarah Bicknell, Recording Secretary Pat Copeland. The Board of Directors, Paula Tripp, Marguerite Thompson, Martha Stewart, Bob Stewart, Marilyn George, Jim Kissick, Elaine Berkeley, Karen Norwood.
Are there any nominations coming from the floor? If not, then we'll vote on this at our next meeting. And again, at the next meeting, I'll ask if there are any nominations from the floor. If not, we'll have the secretary cast a single affirmative ballot. I think that pretty well concludes our business.
Excuse me. The board of directors also includes all the officers. I didn't say that.
That concludes the business part of our meeting for this evening. We're going to turn this over now to the Pelican Man Bird Sanctuary. Ernest Simmons is the sanctuary manager and the wildlife artist, and Alice Mayo Shaw.
Yeah. She one day and saw an injured pelican here on Anna Maria Island, hurt in the mangroves, and went into the mangroves and got the bird and brought it out, took it home, nursed it back to health, and couldn't find a place to take the bird for help. So he decided to take care of the bird at his home, and he had a major heart attack. This was in 1981, and he felt like it was a sign that, and he got a sign from God telling him, and he vowed that he, if he would take care of wildlife, if God would get him through this tragedy of the heart attack, that he would dedicate the rest of his life to taking care of wildlife. So he started the Pelican Man Sanctuary on Anna Maria Island, working out of just a shed. And of course, in '88, the city of Sarasota leased the property on City Island to him for $1 a year. And now we have over 200 pelicans and, well, not just pelicans, but all types of seabirds and other birds at the sanctuary. Over 200 permanently disabled birds. This is Dale in one of the pens. He has a gift with wildlife. He communicates extremely well with wildlife. And he now has 2 rescue trucks, a hospital, a rehab center. We have a gift shop, an administration building, and just the grounds are beautiful. I don't know if you've been there recently, but you'll notice some big changes being made down there. We treat close to 7,000 birds a year that come through the sanctuary. This is Mona. She is the vice president of the sanctuary and will be taking over when Dale is gone. This is one of our rescue trucks. We put 150,000 miles on our rescue trucks last year. We have 2 rescue trucks that are on the road. They're in radio contact with a dispatcher. This is one of our volunteers holding a pelican here. We have several rescue volunteers. If anybody here would like to get involved volunteering at the sanctuary, we always need volunteers. This is a barred owl that was rescued, brought to the sanctuary, rehabilitated, and released back into the wild. This is an interesting shot because you can see the power lines here, and this is your pier, I think, isn't it?
Yeah.
A lot of the pelicans and seabirds run into problems with power lines. 90% of all of their injuries are directly or indirectly related to man. For instance, flying into a power line, breaking a wing, getting electrocuted, getting hit by a car, getting shot, getting tangled in monofilament fishing line, getting poisoned by pesticides. These are all injuries that are related directly to man. Some injuries we get, I have a photograph coming up in here of a duck that was bit by a snapping turtle. Alligator attacks, those would be natural things that do happen to birds in the wild. This pelican right here has a lump in his throat. A lot of times the fishermen will fillet fish and throw them parts that are too big for them to swallow and they get lodged in the pelican's throat. I've always encouraged people not to feed the pelicans. It's just causing them to become dependent on man. And if nobody fed any of the wild birds except birdseed, we wouldn't have as many problems today, I don't think, as we do. This is a bird that got caught in the oil spill in Tampa Bay. You can see how tragic this is. The Pelican Man Sanctuary was involved in taking care of some of the oil birds and managed to get quite a few cleaned up with Dawn dishwashing liquid. This is one that they cleaned up and they got released back into the wild. Several of the volunteers came in and really pulled together and we got them back out into the wild. This is a natural mangrove island. This is where wild pelicans roost at night and during the daytime, and they also breed and have their nesting colonies in the mangrove islands. One of the big problems with the brown pelican, of course, is the monofilament fishing line. These birds hang around the fishing piers. They sometimes go after your bait, get accidentally hooked. The best thing to do if you hook a pelican is try to reel the bird in slowly, without breaking the line. If you have a pair of wire cutters, you can push the hook through, cut the barb, and back it out just like you would if you hooked yourself. The critical thing is to get all the fishing line off the bird. If the bird flies into the mangroves, like this bird here, with fishing line trailing behind him, he gets tangled up, he starts to flap around, and he'll end up hanging to death. And it's a very, very cruel death. This was a young great horned owl that we put back into the nest. You can see the parent up on the right and the juvenile in the laundry basket. It was attached to the tree, put in there, and the parents came back and took care of it. This time of year, we get a lot of baby birds. We get inundated with hundreds of baby birds. They get blown out of the nest. People find them on the ground. My suggestion is that if the bird is a fledgling and has all of its feathers and is hopping around on the ground, you just let it alone, because the parents will come down and feed it. Some people pick them up and bring them to us, and then we encourage that they take it back out at that age and take it back to the parents. If the bird doesn't have any feathers and is all skin, obviously it's left the nest too early or fallen out of the nest, then we ask that it be brought to the sanctuary and we'll raise it with birds of its own type and then get it released back into the wild. The top bird here is an American anhinga. You can see how short the beak is on this bird. The upper and lower mandible were broken, so we gave him a home at the sanctuary. The birds at the bottom are all in a rehabilitation pen. We have the American wood stork. Behind the wood stork is a gannet. We have a laughing gull and a common loon on the lower left. The rehab pen is an area where the birds are kept for a period of time. After they come out of the hospital to recuperate. Some of the injuries, this great blue heron, the upper mandible was broken off. Now in a situation like this, normally we would take the lower mandible and cut it even so that the bird could still pick up fish. Beaks do not grow back. So in this case, this bird would never be released back into the wild, but we would give him a home there. This is a frigate bird. A lot of times you'll see the frigates fly in closer to shore during storms out in the Gulf of Mexico. They're extremely hard to rehabilitate. Brown pelican, you can see right here on the wing, this is caused from monofilament line. The line wraps so tight around the wing it cuts the circulation off and actually cuts down to the bone. This laughing gull has a plumage problem. He was one of our patients at the sanctuary. And if you look at this double-crested cormorant, you'll see that he has a leader hanging out of his mouth. Now obviously this bird dove under and saw fish on a fisherman's hook, swallowed it. In a case like this, you try to reel the bird in. Cormorants can bite, so if you have a landing net and can get the net over the bird, the best thing to do is to... I recommend to any boaters that are out fishing to take a big pillowcase in their boat with them. It makes a great place. It's easy to store a bird in. And it can be brought to the sanctuary and we can remove the hook. This duck was bitten by a turtle. And believe it or not, it lost its beak. We have it at the sanctuary and it's doing fine. It's one of the few cases where the injury wasn't directly related to man. This is the American anhinga. These birds are interesting because when they are done fishing and swimming underwater, they have to come out and spread their wings to dry. They have a very weak oil gland, and the reason for that is they don't want buoyancy. They want to be able to sink when they go in the water so that they can swim like a diver underneath and spear fish. You'll see them in fresh water quite a bit. Some of our residents here, this is a blind brown pelican. They do fine when you feed them. You have to kind of talk to them and tap them on the beak and they open their mouth and you throw the fish down their pouch. We have a couple of them like that. This is a common loon. Now loons come to Florida in the wintertime. They migrate from the Midwest. When they come down here, this is how they look. They're all brown, so a lot of people mistake them for ducks. Up north, they have the green heads and the dark bodies and the white spots, and they have a beautiful call. When they come down here, a lot of times they're exhausted from the migration, and they'll actually land at low light, in low light conditions in parking lots, thinking that it's water. And you'll find them beached when they get sick. and they're extremely hard to rehabilitate. You can see this one is on a piece of foam rubber. Loons have a very sharp keel bone, and if they stay on the ground too long or on anything too firm, their keel bone will actually cut through their chest. So it's very important to keep them on a padded surface. In the wild, they're always on sphagnum moss or bogs or grassy little floating islands. This is the pileated woodpecker. This is a youngster. Now, we have two woodpeckers at the sanctuary in the cage, and boy, they really can tear apart wood. We had to actually take wire and put it out from the wood because they're just like a jackhammer. They'll hit it from one direction and hit it from the other, and a big chunk of wood will fly off. And they completely destroy the inside of the cage, so we were constantly patching holes in it with chunks of metal and sheet metal and wire. This is a Muscovy duck, resident at the sanctuary. And this is a hen mallard. She just had little babies. Day before yesterday, I was in cleaning the pen, and several of the babies were running around and playing in there. And her babies, of course, will be released. This is a hen wood duck. The drakes are beautiful birds. This is the drake. And they're native to Florida. In the wild, they'll eat acorns. They do nest in hollow trees. And they primarily like freshwater lakes. This is an interesting story. This Muscovy duck, the adult in the center, we use as a surrogate parent. These babies came in from several different broods that were found, and we put it with this duck, and she raises them for us. So it's a neat little system. This is the double-crested cormorant. And the reason they get the name double-crested cormorant, in the springtime, on the back of the head, right up here, they get these two tufts coming off. They call it a double crest. And they get a shiny black color to them, and the mouth, the actual inside of the mouth, turns bright blue. And the eye you see here is turquoise. It turns even brighter color than that during breeding season. They're very common. The way to tell the cormorant from the anhinga is to remember cormorant starts with the C, so remember the hook on the C. The cormorant has a hooked beak. The anhinga starts with an A. Remember the point for the pointed beak on the anhinga. That's the easiest way to remember. Sandhill crane. You see these a lot out by Myakka, out in some of the big ranch areas. They probe in the dirt and try to find worms and mole crickets and insects. They also eat a lot of grain. And we have a year-round colony in the state of Florida of sandhill cranes. And then we also have some migrants that come in for the winter in large groups. So you'll see more in the wintertime down here. He has a broken right wing. You can see how it's hanging down. They get this beautiful red when they're adults. When they're juveniles, they're kind of a rusty color of brown. If you look real close at this one, you'll see the lower mandible is missing. And our veterinarian, Dr. Mosler, cut the upper mandible off even, and now we have the bird. We're afraid to release the bird because we just don't think that it would have the ability to root around in the dirt and find food. So we feed it out of a dish now, and he's doing fine down there. This is Maxwell. Maxwell is one of our turkey vultures. Vultures are interesting. They don't have feathers on their head, so when they're feeding on carrion, they don't get all the blood and guts all over their head and have to clean their feathers. So this is the black vulture. You can tell these birds apart in flight because the black vulture has a quicker wing beat and has a little bit of a whitish color on the bottom of the primary feathers, which are the main flight feathers. So if you see them soaring around, the black vulture has a kind of a quick wing beat, and then they glide, quick wing beat, and they glide, and the turkey vultures just seem to glide forever. And the black vultures have a shorter, more squared off tail, but they're both native to Florida, and they're abundant. This is a royal tern. You'll see these birds flying out over the water, and they'll dive straight down and splash into the water and grab bait fish off the surface. And you'll see them sitting like this along the beaches. This is the great blue heron. This is a beautiful bird. You can see this is an adult. He's an adult, has the plumes on the back of the head and the rusty color on the thighs. This is the little blue heron. These are about one third the size of the great blue heron, and you'll see these birds wading around the golf courses and little bayous feeding on bait fish. This is an immature black-crowned night heron. When he gets to be an adult, he'll look like this. And they're a very elusive bird during the daytime. They hide in the mangroves. At night, once in a while, even on the bridges, as you drive over the bridge, you'll see them around the lights feeding on minnows and bait fish. They have a very large eye because they're nocturnal and they can allow a lot of light in to see the bait fish. This is Angie. Angie is an imprinted crow that we have at the sanctuary. Somebody raised Angie from a baby, and Angie thinks that she's a human being, not a crow. So we cannot release her, and she's perfectly healthy. She flies around the pen. She says, "Oh boy." She says, "No way," and a couple of other words. But she has to stay at the sanctuary because we're afraid if we let her go, she'll fly up to somebody and land on their shoulder and want to talk to them. So.
What do you mean by imprinted?
Imprinted is when a bird is very, very young and starts to focus in the first 24 hours of when the egg hatches and the bird is actually starting to focus. When they imprint, they think that if you were to raise this bird and it saw you as it was focusing, it would think that it was you were its parent, and it would associate you itself with being like you. If there's an adult bird there, which is the ideal situation, then it will think it's a bird. But we have to be very careful when we have very young babies not to imprint those birds, because once you imprint a bird, it's very difficult to get it to release back into the wild. These are some pigeons, show pigeons, that we have at the sanctuary. This is the catalegret. Catalegrets are interesting. Their feet and legs and beaks change color throughout the year. During the breeding season, it turns bright orange, and then normally they would be a yellow color. This bird here has its breeding colors on. This is the snowy egret. You can see the black legs and the yellow feet, and then the black beak. These birds are both about the same size, and they're hard to tell apart. If you remember, the yellow slippers is the snowy egret. They have yellow feet. This is the great egret. A very large bird, very common. I'm sure you've all seen great egrets around. During the breeding season, the lure, the skin part here is called a lure, that turns bright green during the breeding season. And they get the plumes on the back here, right down here, these long plumes. This is, in the 1800s, this bird was almost hunted to extinction for the plumes for decorating ladies' hats. And then the Audubon Society passed laws and started protecting them. These are some resident Canada geese that we have at the sanctuary. Dale walks them around and they follow them. The white pelican, they're migratory. They come to Florida for the winter. We got our first white pelican in. I helped to rescue it with some employees about 3 months ago when I was volunteering there. These are some flamingos. Everybody that comes to Florida thinks that flamingos are native to Florida, and they're not. So I always like to talk a little bit about that. In the 1800s, there were reports of nesting colonies in the Florida Keys. But right now, the only flamingos are in South America. And once in a while, we get some stragglers that escape from bush gardens or zoological parks, and you'll see them. But they're really not native to Florida. This is a young flamingo here. It's interesting, they feed on algae and plankton with their beak. It has a sieve and they swing it around in the water. This is a screech owl, very common, and you'll hear them at nighttime. I'll do a call and maybe you'll recognize it, but this is what they sound like. I don't know if you've ever heard that at night, but this is the little guy that does that. And this one has one eye, so we kept it because we thought we had trouble hunting. The depth perception and their hunting skills have to be very good in order to catch insects in flight. But that's primarily what they feed on, roaches, mole crickets, small lizards, mice, any small animal. This is a red-faced screech owl. There's three different, actually, they used to call them phases, but they're actual color morphs. You have red phase or morph, brown and gray. In Florida, gray seems to be the most popular. This is a very common owl in Florida. You'll see these in cypress swamps and hardwood hammocks. This is called the barred owl. And they have a call. I'll try to do it. It sounds like this.
Very good.
And you'll hear them in the swamps at nighttime calling back and forth. Sometimes they get going and it sounds like a bunch of drunk Indians out there. This is the great horned owl. Beautiful bird. I think they're probably one of the most beautiful birds that we have. The birds, of all the birds of prey, I think they're the prettiest. Very intricate feather detail. This is looks like either an immature red-shouldered hawk or a broad-winged hawk. I'm going to guess and say it's a broad-winged hawk. You can see the large talons on these birds. Very powerful. They kill with their feet, not their beaks. They swoop down and grab the prey, and they just squeeze as hard as they can with their feet and thrust their talons in and kill the prey. This is the red-shouldered hawk, the most common hawk in Florida. And they're very vocal. You'll hear them crying out during the daytime, very active. You'll see them as you're driving out Route 72 or Route 64 on fence posts and up in the trees. This is the osprey. You have a lot of these out around Anna Maria Island. They feed 100% of their diet is fish. The bald eagle. We have a few of those in the area. Quite a few inland on the ranch land. They nest in tall pine trees. And they feed on fish also. We accept any type of wildlife. This is a baby raccoon. We do try to have certain people that raise these for us, but we accept any type of wildlife, and we think all life is precious and deserves to be saved. This is an immature brown pelican. When pelicans are young, they have a brown head, a brown body, and a white belly. This bird here is under 2 years old. When he gets to be an adult, he'll have gray feathers, a white head or a yellow head, according to what season it is. The male and female are identical in appearance. The only way you can tell is the male has a longer beak and a little larger body than the female. This is Dale, our founder, feeding Mary. Mary's a domestic goose that we have at the sanctuary. And another one of his friends. This is a very young pelican, I would say probably a month old. You can see he still has the downy feathers. And a lot of times they fall out of the nest. Once a pelican falls out of the nest, he's history. The parents will not come down and take care of him. So once in a while, some fishermen will find him and bring him to us. This is a, kind of an overview of the sanctuary. We have all of our pens. We started building these covers because it gets so hot here that we provided some shade for people. And it's really, it's truly a beautiful place now. I painted a mural down there where the waterfall was. I've got a shot of that in here. Slides of my artwork. So I moved to Sarasota, let's see, a year and a half ago from Clearwater, and moved to Florida, started painting birds when I was 7 years old, started sketching them, then I started painting when I was 14, and when I got out of high school, I turned down some basketball scholarships and decided to do outdoor art shows and sell my bird paintings at art shows. My family moved to Florida in 1975 and started studying the Florida wildlife. And my earlier works were like this. I had white backgrounds, I did a lot of detail and concentrated more on the subject than I did the background. And as time went on, I started moving to, you know, doing a little bit more backgrounds in the work. This is an osprey painting. I work in watercolor and gouache, which is an opaque watercolor. This is a miniature. This is this painting was only 5x7. And this one here is very small also. This is like let me think, this one was about, this is a little 8x10 miniature. This was a larger piece, I think 30 by 40 inches. And you can see how I started putting in more backgrounds and making them look more like photographs. Cardinal. Florida panther. There's actually this painting here. There is an ant crawling in here. I forgot where I put them on the leaves somewhere. But the painting is about that's close to the size of. It's a little smaller than that. I was gonna say maybe 30 by 40 inches. And the white ibis. What's that? I don't know. I don't know. Great egret. The art critic for the Sarasota Herald Tribune just ripped this painting apart. She said it looked like a tattoo on a velvet background. So. Joan Altavi, she just. I hung the article in the gallery next to the original, next to the painting. This is a little kayak that I use for photographing wildlife to get reference, and it has a trolling motor built into it, and it has a handle on the right side for steering, and it has three speeds, forward and reverse, and it really works well for photographing. And I have a blind that I use to get really close when I can't get close to a lot of different ducks. I have this inner tube blind with a cover that pulls over it, and I can get right, I mean, from here to this chair away from ducks, and they don't even know I'm there. The only problem is I can't use it on lakes where there's alligators because my feet are dangling down below the surface.
You don't shoot from the blind, do you?
There's a little hole. You can see my camera on that little shelf in front of me there, and there's an opening about this big, and I just stick the lens through. And I can, if the water's shallow, I can just, you know, crawl real slow, and they just think I'm a floating bush, floating closer to them. It works really well.
Did you ever run into water pipes?
Never really had a problem with snakes too much. I've been all over the state of Florida, and most of the cottonmouths that I've seen are up in the panhandle, around Steinahatchee and Osceola. Also, Pasco County, there's quite a few water moccasins, and it seems like where I see one, I see more the same day in the same area. This is my art gallery in Sarasota. I live in an artist colony, and I live upstairs, and this is the gallery downstairs. It's a historical home. I guess it was built in the 1800s and has some sliding pocket doors, but it's been converted to a gallery. It has track lighting, and we have 22 artists that live on the block. It's called the Tolles Court. It's right in downtown Sarasota. And I think that's it. No. Here's the mural that I painted at the sanctuary. I was volunteering there. When I moved to Sarasota, I was volunteering one day a week cleaning out cages. And they had this waterfall that poured over. It was just a white wall. So I talked with Dale, and Dale said, why don't you paint a mural on it? So I went down there and spent the whole summer. Well, not the whole summer, but I could only work on it from sunrise to 11:30, because then the sun came over the wall, and it was so hot. There's this black rubber pool in front of it, and the water pours over it now and runs down the wall. And I tore out the black plastic in front of it and made a concrete pond with river rock around it. We've got plants around it, and it's beautiful now. I've got to get a shot of the whole thing now. Just came out really nice. Okay, that's it.
Thank you very much. I'm sure we all enjoyed it. I found it both interesting and educational. One thing confused me, however.
Yes.
The commercial was not louder than the program. Question. How do they take off the top bill or bottom bill of a bird? Do you use a saw device?
They use a saw, and then they can shape it with a Dremel with a stone on the end of it. Also, they do bleed when you do that, so they use a powder called Quick Stop, and they push the powder on there, and it absorbs the blood.
So the blood vessels in the bill?
Yes, yes. Up to a certain point. When you get out toward the tip, you can, you know, trim it and cut it without it bleeding, but there are blood vessels in the bead.
Mm-hmm.
You're welcome. Question? Yes.
First, I want to tell you your paintings are beautiful.
Thank you.
Are they available at the Bird Sanctuary?
Yes. The gift shop that we have sells a poster that I did of 28 different water birds all together on the same poster, and it has